Hi there, my name is Will Jeffrey from Project 369, and we're continuing our series of interviews with partners in our network. And we're delighted to bring in Anna Buenafe, who has joined us. Anna is a strategic marketeer. She is going to take us through her background, having worked in hyper-casual, mobile, mid-core through hardcore. And she has a particular set of experience that's really useful around influencer campaigns and influencer management. And she's able to relate her experience of working in these channels, particularly around YouTube and TikTok, and very candidly and honestly shared a lot of useful insights, particularly around how to make it work at a small scale and no budget scale, as well as a big scale. So let's go and meet Anna. People. So Anna, welcome. Nice to kind of get this opportunity to talk with you and to record this. How about starting off? Just tell us, you know, how you got into games, what inspired you, and what was your path into the industry?
Yeah, absolutely. This is my pleasure to be here and record the podcast. I'll start from very, very beginning. I happen to be born in a family where my dad is a programmer, and moreover, he's a gamer. So I've been exposed to gaming since I was 3 years old. I used to play video games with my father, with my brothers, and it have been always a natural part of my life. I don't know how sport is for some people. I would say for me, that's video games. I play on every device. I play on every platform, all of the genres. And it's always been like this. It's just part of my life. And as a rebel teenager, I went to study marketing because it's enough of tech people in my family. And I fell in love with marketing. It's absolutely an activity that I like to do. I worked some time in the advertising platform on the platform side, helping people to set up their campaigns, to be efficient with them, to make sure that the money they spend for advertising giving a good return on investment. And after about 3 years in customer success team, I wanted to move and to have this marketing experience on the client side, to be the one setting those campaigns, to decide how do you drive the marketing. And when I was looking for the company to join, it just nearly randomly happened that game development company from my hometown have been hiring for a marketing manager. And in a way, it's a coincidence where the right time, right place happen. And I joined. I fit right in because of all of my gaming experience. I fit right in because of my understanding of the customer support, customer engagement in general. And I knew all of the technical things you needed to know about marketing. And then my journey went in game development industry, basically covering all of the genres from like hidden object games, match three casual games, to mid-core and hardcore projects, where my last gaming project was DayZ, which is hardcore survival game where people can walk for hours, and they do walk for hours, and never have any interaction with another player. But yeah, I worked with mobile, worked with social games, worked with PC, worked with console, released all type of genres, all type of projects, from single player to multiplayer. And I have to say, I love it.
Great. I mean, it might just be nice if you could kind of tell us about the specific jobs and the places that you've worked, for us to kind of understand, you know, where your career's been, and you know, some of the places where you feel that you've formed that experience up the most.
Well, absolutely. So one of my first jobs happened to be the corporations where I was supporting the advertising platform. And from there went for middle size established studio, who was one of the leaders in the social games, company called Alavar. Right now it's more of an indie studio that develops mid-core games, very fun, very different in genres, but they are rather small. They pivoted many years ago into this direction. But back then it was probably one of the most popular hidden object games, one of the most popular match three games. And it was, oh my God, like 10 years ago, nearly. There, One of the first things that I applied, I was introducing the two core elements, one being building the community, and you might be surprised how passionate Match 3 community might be. And my proudest moment was turning the haters into the advocates of our product. And the second part that I experienced in this company is I learned how to better monetize the games, right? It wasn't only about the running the advertising, but it was also about finding the right place to insert the advertising in the game. How do you do rewards in the game? How do you bring this ad money into your project, right? Because casual games, free to play, this is pretty much one of the monetization ways, right? When you have millions and millions of players, that's absolutely what you need. Then from there, I was headhunted to My Games. My Games is quite big in the mobile space as well. I started to work on mobile MOBA, which have released and which is my failed project. But I learned a lot. I started to play League of Legends, which I still play. And there I started to work with influencers, because working with a hardcore, even mobile game, influencers is one of your channels to distribute your product. I established my first relationships with top US influencers. One of them became my good friend, like up to this date. And I learned, okay, what are the metrics that you need? How do you structure the deals with the creators? What do's and don'ts you should not or should do? And I worked with crazy budgets on this project. Didn't work out for us because it was also a very new genre to bring on the mobile platform, but it was tremendous learning. And then within the same company, I transitioned to more of a mid-core games as well, mobile, where I started to work in less with streamers, but more with YouTube creators. And there it was another adventure of, okay, what do you learn? What do you publish on YouTube? What type of metrics do you look on YouTube? And not surprising, but the projects there were a lot more successful, where it was one of the fastest return on investment for all of the marketing spend that I had in my career. Literally, like in 2 weeks, the cohort of users that we would acquire would get us all of the money back, and their lifetime value is a lot larger than 2 weeks, as you can imagine.
I think people would like the detail of this case study. It sounds really interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. The game that I was working on back then that was best return on investment is named Hawk Freedom Squadron. It is still live and operating game. It is amazing shoot 'em up game. You travel through the space. You have to save the galaxy, save your planet. And while the mechanic of the game is rather casual, mid-core, it has amazing feature where you can join in the co-op with another player. Would it be by proximity? I don't know. We are sitting in the same room. We can play together, or just finding the random player or playing with somebody from your friend group while you're on a call with them. And that social aspect definitely worked a lot for us, where the game had like a good metrics on retention. And yet again, being the free-to-play game, you know that majority of the players do not pay you. However, those who did, you needed to identify them. And we pretty much went into the type of profiles that like to win, like to pay to win sometimes, because this was one of the elements. While it's not a competitive game, but like to progress faster, to get further in the game, you still could benefit from, extra money, extra boost. And it did create the competitive feeling within the game itself. So we searched for our players. We did very extensive user research where we understood, okay, what is their motivation? What do they want to achieve? What other games do they even play? And that helped us to identify, for example, different YouTubers who would be fit to promote this game. And by knowing what type of game they are interested in, what type of game style, what type of content your users consuming, you're able to offer them exactly what they're looking for, right? Because when you work with the influencers, it's not about the biggest numbers that the influencer has. It's about the connection that they have with their audience. It's those parasocial relationships that they establish with their audience. And on top of it, we're looking into, let's say, a feed, right? Because I don't know, I cannot advertise shoot an app project on somebody who plays Sims, right? Because it's two different audiences, two different actions. And Sims players maybe will pick up this game, but somebody who's a lot closer to arcade type of style will love it immediately. And then the quality of the traffic that you attract to your game is immediately like converting amazingly. It gives you all of the results. It gives you your audience. It's how you target basically through the influencers. And another interesting element, because we were mobile game, mobiles are very big in Asia, where everybody knows that, like, I don't know, entire Southeast Asia is the land of mobile. It's the first device that they play with on. And we got big there as well, right? Because you have social element, you have mobile as a first device for the product. And then you need to understand that, well, if those regions monetize well for you, you might as well look into the creators who create in their language, just so you expand further on in those regions. So in a nutshell, that's part of the success, part of the reasons why the Hack Freedom Squadron had the results it had, and from there it took off. And I moved to Madfinger Games, which right now already starting to develop their PC title, but yet again then it was a leader in the first-person shooters on mobile. First-person shooter, quite hardcore genre. Would it be more of a single-player experience? And we also had the multiplayer experience. But the interesting thing about it, moving from corporation to the independent studio, I had lost all of my budget. I had to work with zero. And, well, I think up to date, my biggest video that I ran for Madfinger Games, like biggest influencer partnership that I received, has 5 million views for one video alone. And so I had to understand what is the motivation of the influencers, what would be the reason why they would cover you in the first place, right? And how do you make the project exciting enough for them that they want to cover it for free? And I was very greedy. I was reaching out hundreds and hundreds, building the database that is suiting for this project. And I would say that in the time we were releasing Shadowgun Legends, which probably about 9 months of me working in a company, we not just established like a really solid community of the content creators who want to work with us no matter what, but we got the pre-registration of about 1 million users for mobile game. And then, like, first week when the game was out, it was tremendous success. It got featuring, it got a huge amount of downloads on both Apple and Android. So that was an amazing story as well.
And do you think this is, I mean, it is a great case study. Do you think this is something which you were able to kind of then repeat and apply in other cases?
Absolutely. I think that for me, it's something that gave me a better understanding of, like, it gave me a fundamental understanding of how to work with influencers. Because it doesn't matter what budget you work with, you can always set it up in a way that is beneficial for both you and the creator. Because the nature of this type of marketing, it is being beneficial for the creator. If you're not paying them money for their work, you need to give them something else. Would it be them getting more viewers, getting more, I don't know, them getting exclusive opportunity to cover your game before anyone else does? Getting early peek, getting something for their community, you can always find the way to be successful. Maybe you're not going to work with the biggest creators in the world right away, but also in my one of my later jobs, being voice mod, where we got free coverage from XQC, we got free coverage from the world, like top 10 streamers on Twitch without paying a penny, just because our product was fit for content creators, because it was giving them the opportunity to show something really cool for their audience, because their audience is their main source of income. And on top of it, it got the, it was content, right? Content creators sell content. And we gave it to them. We gave them the opportunity to have the experience on screen. And I would say that depending of what you want to reach, depending of what marketing budget you have to invest into influencers, you can have the same results. Well, independent of what type of budget you have, you can have the same results, but it will be different type of work that you need to approach. Because when you have monetary transaction, it's a lot easier to convince somebody to work with you and to cover your project. But the quality of this coverage might be questionable, right? It can be a very well-known mobile game that have been all over YouTube. I'm not going to call the name, but it's like same copy-paste text that every YouTuber have been reading. Is it engaging? No. Is it driving the users? Probably, considering that they spent a lot of budget on the advertising. But if you're looking into quality coverage that actually lets your game shine, doesn't matter if you pay the creator or you don't pay and you work on a free collaboration, it is a lot better result for you, for your promotion, and it builds the connection between your future player and your game already. And of course, it helps the creator.
Mm-hmm. Did you find that this experience of working with influencers in this way, because this was sort of almost pre-TikTok in your work,
yes.
Did that inform the way, because you've had great success in the work with TikTok? I mean, take us through that, and did you apply the same principles, or was that did this require its own unique strategy?
I would say learning about content creators helped me to learn about content, right? Because TikTok is ultimately a content platform. And when you spend hours and hours watching Twitch stream, when you spend hours watching YouTube, you understand, okay, this works, this doesn't work. You understand that content is all about grind as well. And you learn not only the algorithms, because yeah, algorithms are important, but you learn what works and what doesn't. And sometimes you can have like amazing idea for the content piece for one video, and just one change in execution gives you 1 million of the views in difference. So I would say yes, it helped me to understand the TikTok, the way that it works, but then actually having this hands-on experience and building the TikTok strategy for voice mod resulted into me being able to work with it and to be successful. Basically, we started from zero on a TikTok, 4 years ago already, when the TikTok just started to get off, to take off. And we, within 3 months, I say, we got our first 1 million views video, which is great to have 1 million views, but it didn't result in any revenue metrics. So exposure, yes, it gave us exposure. It built the awareness for the audience that we had, but it didn't move the metrics that are the most important for the business, the money. It took us about 3 more months to figure out how to convert those views into the paying users. And I would say the biggest element that you need to implement into anything related to the content is grind. You have to fail, you have to repeat, you have to iterate every day. And the consistency of your production resulting into you being successful, right? You have to look into how audience reacts to your product. You have to look how much they react into, well, how much do they convert into your users, right? Because one thing is to see amazing piece of content and laugh and share it with your friend. But another thing is to say, hey, I actually want to try this product that they show it to me. I want to play this game and go and try it. And there's another thing that actually has a similarity between TikTok and influencers. Both of it, these sources of user acquisition, they're not very trackable. Like, I've got to deal a lot with executives who want to see metrics, who want to see the numbers exactly. Okay, I put $10 here. How do I know that this $100 that came back is from these $10? And it's impossible. I would say it is. Like, yes, you can see it, but it's like with organic traffic, you're gonna see the uplift in the metrics. You're gonna see results coming, but you're not able to say 100% it's from this person. Some percentage of the users you are able to track, right? You can give the promotional code, you can have the trackable link both in your TikTok video or with your influencer. But I don't know, I watch TikTok from my mobile, but if I'm gonna play the PC game, I'm not gonna click the link on the mobile. And therefore, you're not gonna have me as a user identified as coming from the TikTok. So you're always gonna see uplift and organic, and well, it's incredibly effective. Maybe another thing that might be worth enrolling is that actually influencers was a reason why we resurrected Daisy. So Daisy was an interesting project. I think everybody who works in the industry is quite familiar, right? We created the precedent on Steam of game being 7 years in early access with its initial success when it was announced. It nearly lost all of its player base, all of its user base by the time that it released on the PC. And but when I was joining the team, the company have moved all of the people away from the project. Some got laid off, some got moved to different projects of the company like Arma. And well, it was from 80 to 20 people, very demoralized team, very, I would say, let's see what happens. And if we survive, good type of mood in the team. And the company was ready to close the project completely. This being said, well, we flipped the script. The benefit of having the cross on your project is beautiful because, well, you have your resources, you know what you have, what you can do, but you cannot fail because, like, there's nowhere to go. Like, you're already at your lowest low. And therefore, you can do whatever you want. Like, whatever you do, gonna give you results. So I got this freedom to experiment and got this freedom to work on all of the knowledge and, like, all of the experience that I acquired previously and just go for it. And I would say that main pillar and main driver for Daisy to resurrect it was the community of the influencers. And we had like very, very short sponsored campaign when we released the console versions of the Daisy. That was our last chance moment where if we're not successful, we're going to close. We released it and we had a bunch of the influencers covering it on the PC. So you can still have promotion of your console game, even though creators work play the PC version of it. And we paid for like 4 hours of sponsored content. But what it resulted in, because game was already in a pretty good state, the streamers continued playing the game for 2.5 months. And you could see it in the metrics because the game is in a good state. The game is very, very enjoyable right now. And the way that we executed the campaign, well, it got hyped created the hype in the community. So I'm gonna tell my secrets, I guess. Not so much of a secret, to be fair. But I would say when you're looking at the streamer campaign, you can have a tiny budget, but the most important thing for you is a good coordination of the content creators. And who ever worked with streamers, whoever worked with the content creators, know how hard it is, how much work it is to coordinate them. But the key to success with the streamers is to get them all stream at the same time, right? Because what it results into, you have the outburst into the numbers of viewership, right? Even if it's just 1 hour, 1 hour of sponsored content, have all of your streamers going live in this 1 hour. Twitch, very simple platform for navigation, right? It actually sorts the game by the number of viewers. And the number of concurrent viewers that you have in the moment, it piques the interest, right? Oh, what is this new game that is trending right now? I'm gonna go check it out. And because people go and check out your game, they see how it's played. They see the feeling that influencer has, how much joy they have, or what are the weird elements they encounter in a game, what are surprises, whatever is the benefits of your game design, basically, they're gonna see it on screen, they're gonna leave it together through their favorite creator, and then they're gonna go and try this game. And when it's multiplayer game, even better, they're gonna go and try to stream snipe their favorite streamer, basically join the same server and try to be there with them. But why it's important even more to have all of the streamers in the same time when you're sponsoring is not just your audience, it's also the streamers. When you're basically advertising your product to players and you're advertising your product to content creators in the same time. Because how do streamers decide what else to cover if they play more than one game? They go on top of Twitch, they see what's trending, and they're like, oh, I gotta jump on the trend. And they show it to their new audience. So you have your game in, I don't know, top 5 of Twitch. You're gonna get just more new content creators trying it out. And that's it. And it's your free marketing, your key to success on anything streaming. Similar with YouTube, similar with other platforms, but you need to coordinate all of your influencer efforts very well.
That's a good bit of insight there. Very very useful. Thank you for sharing. How do you think now that you know, in the way the industry is, you're able to take this experience and apply it? Well, the opportunity is that people can work with you as a kind of consultant now, which is a great opportunity, which is why we're speaking.
Yeah, absolutely. I started with consulting some of my friends from the industry, former colleagues, with their new studios, and that got me, that and talking to you got me to consulting. I do all things strategic marketing wise, right? I specialize on brand, on influencers, community, content creation for your product. And I would say that everything that, every problem that you have connected to your marketing, connected to your players, I can help you solve it. I'll need to know what it is, but ultimately I like building the strategy. I like teaching your team. I can help you with your hands-on experience, come and set up this influencer program, depending on the needs, depending on the type of company. Because one thing, you are releasing one game and you need success for this game. Another thing, you have, game as a service. You need to have absolutely different setup of the influencer strategy. Or if you're a publisher, you have a lot of games coming on every month, hopefully. And you need to have the network of influencers. You basically, like, depending on the type of a business you're running, depending on the type of product you're releasing, you need to understand what works for you. Would it be community? Would it be influencers? Would it be even arranging your own team? I've been working, managing marketing teams for about 7 years, ever since I started. And I have established the teams who run it, like, from scratch. I enjoy it a lot. I think that hiring the right people is your road to success. And I can help with this as well. So I can help you setting up the strategy. I can help you to execute this strategy if you need this help, if you have nobody in-house. I can teach your team how to do it. I can build your team for you if you need it. So that's probably the areas where I'm most useful. And looking at the type of companies who might want to hire me, I would say, yeah, absolutely everybody who has customer-facing products within the gaming space. Would it be game development studio? Would it be a publisher? Would it be, let's say, a complementary product for gamers? I can help you to address this audience, right? I've been working with zero budget, and if you have no budget at all, just for the consulting services, I can help you work with this. Or if you have hundreds, thousands, millions of monthly budgets to spend, I can make sure that it's not just a big budget that you're spending, but you're getting a return on this investment.
That's very good. I was thinking that there's one question I just wanted to ask, which is there a question that you would have liked to have been asked that you haven't been asked?
The good one. Yes. what makes marketing in games hard? And I don't think marketing in games is hard. For me, it has been always very natural and very easy. The hard part that I think a lot of people are missing is that there is no universal solution that works for everybody. And you need to align all of your efforts. It's not just performance marketing. It's not just community marketing. It's not just influencer marketing that you're running. All of those channels have to work together and create the synergy that will result into your profit and into your fame, into all of the results that you want to achieve.
And how do you achieve that synergy? What is it you need to do in order to make sure those things are aligned?
How do I do it? I just have quite systematic thinking, like, what is the first goal that we need? What is our path to this goal? How do we measure our success, right? And then you look into what's available to you in terms of resources and what is your product. So you combine your resources, you combine your product, and you make the best of it, basically. You look into the shortest way to the heart of your future customer, the shortest way to the heart of the player? And how do you build these relationships with your player, right? Because first of all, they need to find out that you even exist. What platforms are they using? How do they learn about your products? Are they only looking at what's trending on Steam? Are they only looking into Reddit threads? Okay, you need to be there. And understanding the user, understanding their needs and how your product can benefit their needs and can satisfy their needs is how you identify the right channels and synchronize those channels between one another. And you implement the right marketing efforts for every stage of the user journey, from awareness to ultimately leading this player becoming your main advocate and selling this game for you.
That's very good. Anna, I think that's fantastic. There's a lot of insights, a lot of experience there that you've shared with us, which is excellent. How can people get in touch with you? Obviously, they can get in touch with you through Project 369, but tell us where they can follow you.
They can follow me on LinkedIn. It's very easy to find me. My name, Anna, is double N, Buenafe. Nobody can spell it, but you will write it down for this video. And yeah, I'm not hiding. You can find me by my name on every social network. I do prefer LinkedIn for work topics, but you can follow me on Twitter and read how I'm fighting with a bank or what my cats have eaten for dinner.
Great. Thank you very much. Really nice talking to you.
Likewise.
So that was a great interview from Anna, and I think you can see there's a huge amount of skills, experience and insights that she's able to bring. And that's very much at the kind of core of what we do in Project 369, bringing companies, services and people together to solve a whole range of games marketing and publishing challenges. So if you'd like to work with us, please get in touch. Or if you'd actually think that you have a skill, a talent or a service and you'd like to be part of our network and our ecosystem, we'd love to hear from you too. Thank you very much.
At some point of my career, and I was considering the influencer roles, and I was surprised by the amount of money people put into influencer management salaries, which is good. People should be compensated, but I would say that it was not necessary. Like, influencer marketing is not that hard, but also somehow a lot of companies put like massive budgets into influencer marketing and fail it. Like, it's insane. Like, you can see some campaigns and you know, like, okay, this is like probably $500,000 behind this campaign, but it has zero results. Or like very, very little results, because you can see like the game is not trending. Nobody is playing the game. It doesn't have the concurrent viewers, but people have spent the money for their campaign. And for me, it's like, how do you feed the influencer marketing in the system? Is easy. Like, you need to understand what is your marketing strategy in general so that you can feed the influencers into it. And then the easy grind begins, right? Because technically it's a lot of exchange of messages, coordination with influencer or influencer agencies. But you need to know the structure of your campaign. You need to understand what you want to achieve in order to even brief the agency, in order to brief the influencer. And somehow a lot of companies don't figure it out. So,
well, I think as you say, that there's been this, I mean, influencers still is a relatively new channel. And so the kind of best practice, the understanding, that expertise, I mean, you know, how many, is it more than 15 years old? I don't know. Maybe that might be as long as it's ever been around in any sense. And there is this still sense that I get that, the influencer channel is a bit like a media buy. You know, you buy these people, you look at their numbers, and that's how you approach it. And you make a good point about the idea that you want to center the activity, influencer activity, on, you know, it's a piece of marketing, and you have to understand how the marketing works, how the audience works, and you describe that very well in understanding that kind of that flow. But often that's not necessarily, as you say, that wouldn't necessarily be shared. That's not necessarily part of the brief when people are saying we want to run an influencer campaign. So you see these bigger activations happening, and you're saying, yes, they're not trending. I wonder how. And perhaps that's an element that is absent in the briefing process.
Well, the thing is also, like, a lot of people think, okay, if I get the top influencer, I'm going to be successful. But it's not true. It's a lot better to go with a smaller creator. Top influencer, they're going to be fine financially, first of all. But they're also not going to connect with your product for most of the time. And moreover, like, why influencer marketing is so effective is the connection that creator has with their audience. And they only able to contain it when they, like, able to interact with each other. There's some talented people, I don't know, same XQC, he's able to read his very fast moving chat and react to it immediately. But in general, like, somebody who has 20,000 concurrent users who all simultaneously chatting and talking to you, you're not able to support this conversation. Therefore, you're not able to establish the connection with this viewer. Therefore, whatever you're selling is not going to have the same results as if you have, I don't know, 1,000 viewers, some of them chatting, but you really connect with them. You know, like, what influencer marketing reminds me, in the nutshell, not marketing-wise, but like a social dynamic, is in an old time, I used to play with my brothers, like, take turns of who gets access to the PC and who gets to play the next round. And I would sit behind their back and I would watch, and we would chat in between it. And I would say, like, no, I don't know, like, go in this direction or pick this item or take the other quest. And that's exactly the relationships that streamers establish with their viewers. Maybe they're not talking that much about the game itself, but they would talk about how their day is going. What are the trending topics in the world? And this connection creates a trust that viewer has to whatever influencer has to say. And therefore, it creates a trust towards the game that they're playing. And of course, if streamer or other type of content creator is clearly enjoying your product, clearly enjoying your game, their viewers gonna play it. They're gonna love it. So it's not that hard.
Interested to know, I mean, you talk to this the kind of principle of this alignment of the game and their interest, and you're very right that is what's going to that's going to resonate with the audience the best and have the most success. When you are a big AAA title release or something, how do you think those principles can be applied at the sort of highest level where they are seeking to engage in, you know, celebrity influencers and paying the big bucks?
Yes, absolutely. And you have this, one of my favorite campaigns of to date is how Apex Legends released. They know we're in a good place in terms of the numbers right now, but they very much had one of the best release campaigns ever, at least historically. They were first off. They invited a lot of the streamers to participate and give the feedback about the game. They invited streamers to play behind the closed doors, a celebrity. Of course, they were paid. But that created the engagement between the streamer and the company and the product, where streamers started to feel connected to the project. And because they were impacting the way that development goes, maybe it's still curated impact, but it is impact. I don't know, fixing the balance of the weapons or introducing some feature or removing some location on a map. Just this type of feedback that is easy for you as a developer to implement results into them being very, very loyal to you and to your product because it's their input. And when you have input into something, you're gonna have this unbreakable connection. So that's one of the ways to promote your like AAA product with the top creators, because they're gonna feel connection to your product. And then when it's time to release, of course they're gonna play it. And of course they're gonna brag how they went to your office, how they helped to, I don't know, change the hair color of this character.
Yeah, that's very good. Good point.
And it's similar, like you work with influencers in a similar way that you work with community, because you're establishing relationships with them. How close of the relationships? Well, probably not like you're establishing relationships with your friend or the loved ones, but it is still the relationships that you have. And the game development industry have been the pioneer, I would say, in community management. Like now moving away from the game development and working directly in the game development company, I can see how my experience in community management can help, I don't know, a B2B software company, something mm-hmm. that is as boring as, I don't know, Microsoft Teams.
Thank you, Microsoft Teams, for allowing us to record today.
Good too, <Yeah. laughs> but not the most exciting.
I think what's interesting there is that the point you make there about this this process, that to enact these principles, I think it requires this forward planning. It requires this kind of understanding of the principles of the marketing, that you have to have that needs to be in place, that needs to be clear. And then you're able to do so much more with it. You know, you can think about how you could build these activations in. You can incorporate, you know, influences into the development process. You're absolutely right. I guess that it's for those that are kind of maybe have that foresight and that organization, like Apex or places, they're able to do that. Yeah.
And I would say that depending on the game, of course, but you should bring your marketing team into the project way before you're ready to release. It should be at least 1 year before release. And then they will be able to succeed. The earlier you bring, the better, right? There's a lot of new studios who bring it like from the prototyping. And this is where marketing can help you as well, because, well, you need to understand what players love, and you need to recruit your typical player who will help you to build and validate your hypothesis. Like, yes, game designers are talented, but they still need to see the feedback from their future players. Because one thing is sitting with your idea in their empty room, and another one is sitting how you executed this idea and how people react. So having marketing early on is always beneficial. You don't need the massive team, but you do need to make sure your game fits the needs of the market and fits the audience needs.
Very true.